Estadio Olimpico, Mexico City. The opening of the 1968 Olympic Games. The final torchbearer enters the stadium. She is 21-year-old Norma Enriqueta Basilio, a hurdler on the Mexican Olympic team. Up the 92 steps to the copper urn that will be the resting place for the flame during the 2 weeks of competition. Norma Enriqueta Basilio is the first woman in the history of the Olympic Games to carry the final torch into the stadium. Fanny Durack's name is the first to officially be listed in the Olympic record book. Other women preceded her in Olympic competition. 12 years before, at the Paris Olympic Games of 1900, Charlotte Cooper of Great Britain wins the women's singles tennis gold medal and then joins her countryman, Reginald Dougherty, to win the mixed doubles championship. Until the year 1924, tennis remained part of the Olympic program. Archery is introduced for women at the 1904 St. Louis Olympic Games. That gold medal is won by perhaps the greatest woman archer of all time. Her name, Margaret Howell of the United States. States championships, climaxing her career with two gold medals in St. Louis. It is Paris, 1922, the Women's World Games, the first Olympic Games exclusively for women. The year before, the International Women's Sporting Federation asked to be included in the track and field competition at the 1924 Olympic Games. The request was turned down. Here in Paris, women athletes from five countries compete in 11 events, including the 1,000 meters, shot put, high jump, and javelin. 6 years after women held their first Olympiad, the International Olympic Committee handed down a momentous decision. Women athletes would now become part of all future Olympiads. It is Amsterdam, 1928. Women's track and field is introduced to the Olympic Games. Five events are scheduled. The 100 meters, 800 meters, 400 meter relay, the discus, and the high jump. The first event, the 100 meters. Fanny Rosenfeld of Canada and Elizabeth Robinson of the United States are co-favorites to win the first gold medal ever awarded to a woman in track and field. There are only four women in the finals. Two have already been disqualified for false starts. Fanny Rosenfeld on the left and Elizabeth Robinson alongside finish in a virtual tie. After many minutes discussion, the officials award the gold medal to Elizabeth Robinson of the United States. Fanny Rosenfeld of Canada and her teammate Ethel Smith are given the same time as the winner. Before the competition ends, Canadian women would win two gold medals, but the honor of being the first woman to ever win an Olympic track and field championship would belong to 16-year-old Elizabeth Robinson of the United States. It is Saturday, July 30th, 1932. The opening day ceremonies of the Los Angeles Olympic Games. 1,500 athletes from 37 countries are entered. One of those competing is perhaps the greatest all-around woman athlete in history. Her name, Mildred Babe Diedrichsen. Babe Diedrichsen amazed the world when her team, the Employers Casualty Company of Dallas, Texas, won the United States Women's Track and Field Championship. The term team championship is misleading. Babe Diedrichsen scored every point. She won the broad jump, shot put, high jump, and javelin. Then she came back to win the 80-meter hurdles. But here at the Los Angeles Games, Olympic rules for women would only permit her to compete in three events. She chooses the high jump, 80-meter hurdles, and javelin. On the first day of competition, the javelin is held. Babe Diedrichsen wins with a toss of 143 feet, 4 inches. 4 days later, she is a finalist in the 80-meter hurdles. Babe Diedrichsen is in lane two, second from the top. Alongside her in lane one is her teammate Evelyn Hall. It is a photo finish between Diedrichsen and Hall. The decision is finally announced. Babe Diedrichsen wins by an inch, and in doing so creates a new world record. Now her third and final event, the high jump. Babe Diedrichsen is the co-favorite along with her teammate Jean Shiley. Jean Shiley, the team captain, remembers the controversial finish against Babe Diedrichsen.
It happened this way. We were jumping along, and we reached the height of 5'5¼". And I made it, and Babe jumped either once or twice, I can't remember, but either on one of those jumps, the judges disqualified her because under the rules, you were not allowed to jump with your shoulder preceding your body over the bar.
It is ruled that Babe Diedrichsen's shoulder has preceded her feet over the bar. In 1932, this is not legal. She could have been disqualified. However, in a controversial ruling, the officials place her second. Throughout the competition, Jean Shiley knew Babe Diedrichsen was jumping illegally and could have protested. For her, this was not the way to win the gold medal.
I want to win it on the field, yes.
The style of jump that Babe uses, the shoulder would precede the body across the bar.
Babe was such a wonderful athlete and had won two previous events that they kind of felt she might win three. We both hold the record jointly, but I won the gold medal.
One of the women athletes who shared honors with Babe Diedrichsen at the Los Angeles Games was her good friend, Eleanor Holm.
She was such a super athlete that she really thought that she could do anything better than anybody on any team. And one of the things that's very vivid in my memory about Babe was Georgia Coleman, who was a great diver and an Olympic medal winner, was the only woman at that time doing a 2.5. And Babe said, easy, I can do that. And I don't think she was ever on a diving board in her life. So the two of them sneaked out. And by gosh, Babe tried to do the 2.5. And of course, she went flat all the way. And she was black and blue from here down. You know, they got in a little trouble with the coaches.
In 1928, at age 14, Eleanor Holm finished fifth in the 100-meter backstroke at the Amsterdam Olympic Games. Now, 4 years later, here in Los Angeles, Eleanor Holm, closest to the camera, is on her way to winning the backstroke medal. She was considered the most beautiful and graceful performer at the Los Angeles Games, constantly being sought out by reporters as the perfect combination of physical beauty and athletic talent.
I can't tell you how happy I am to have been able to win this event. For the last 4 years, I've been thinking of nothing but Olympics, and now that it's over, I can hardly believe it's true. Thank you.
It is August 1936. Eleanor Holm is defending Olympic champion in the backstroke. It is predicted that she will be an easy winner. On the boat to Germany, Eleanor Holm's Olympic career comes to an abrupt end. She is suspended by Avery Brundage, president of the United States Olympic Committee, for drinking champagne while training aboard ship.
I have always felt that Mr. Brundage stole a second gold medal from me, and I also think it was shocking what he did to the United States. I used to train very hard all during the week, on a Saturday or a Sunday, whichever day I was not going to train. I would have a few glasses of champagne, and that's exactly what I did. The foreigners couldn't understand why I would be eliminated and not allowed to swim on the team for just drinking wine, because all the foreigners have their own bottles of wine right on the table, you see. So that was a thing that they couldn't understand. And then, of course, I met all the bad boys, the Hitlers, the Goerings, the Goebbels. I went to every Nazi party there was. It was an interesting thing. Hitler said that if I had been a German athlete, the punishment would have come after if I had lost, not before.
This is the Olympic swimming stadium in Berlin. Daily, Chancellor Hitler would attend the diving competition. It is here that Eleanor Holm would have attempted to win her second Olympic gold medal. This is Marjorie Gestring of the United States. In Berlin, she becomes the youngest girl to ever win a gold medal. She is 13 years and 9 months old.
I'm awfully happy I won this championship, and I owe all my things that I've won to my coach, Fred Cady.
Chancellor Hitler watches Marjorie Gestring receive her admirers.
Adolf Hitler was in attendance. Gestring, which was terribly uncommon in the United States, but is a common name in Germany. He took very special interest and pride in the fact that I was able to achieve what I did. I was impressed, I think, most of all, by his complexion. He had a very rosy-cheeked complexion. Maybe the vegetarian aspect of his life contributed to that.
Wembley Stadium. The day, July 29th, 1948. The opening of the 14th Olympiad of the modern era. Marching with the team from Holland is Fanny Blankers-Koen. 12 years before, at the Berlin Olympic Games, 18-year-old Fanny Blankers-Koen competed in the high jump and 400-meter relay. She did not win any medals. World War II canceled the 1940 and 1944 Olympic Games. Now, here in London, 30-year-old Fanny Blankers-Koen is the oldest woman athlete in competition.
My best friend, Jack Krump, he he wrote in the papers that Fanny Blankers-Koen, she was very good, but she was 30 years old and she was too old to win a gold medal. And I was very angry, and he was my best friend, and when we arrived in London, I told him that. I said, I show you.
Fanny Blankers-Koen will compete in four events: the 100 meters, the 200 meters, 80-meter hurdles, and the 400-meter relay. Ironically, she did not enter in her two best events, the high jump and the long jump. Her first event, the 100 meters. Fanny Blankers-Koen is in lane three, third from the right. Fanny Blankers-Koen comes to London as the most unique performer at the Games. Besides being the oldest woman competitor, she is also married to her coach, Jan Blankers. Her practice sessions would be a family affair, a combination of children's games, picnic lunches, and countless hours of training. Fanny Blankers-Koen wins her first gold medal. 2 days later, Fanny Blankers-Koen is in the final of the 80-meter hurdles. She is in lane one on the inside. Her main opposition, Maureen Gardner of Great Britain, alongside her in lane two. Fanny Blankers-Koen leads, but Maureen Gardner is known for her finishing sprint. It is a photo finish. Maureen Gardner of Great Britain believes she has nipped Fanny Blankers-Koen at the tape. Fanny Blankers-Koen walks to the infield, equally certain she has won. There are several minutes delay as the judges look over the photographs. There is a great cheer as the crowd in Wembley Stadium rises. The band is playing the British national anthem. Fanny Blankers-Koen is confused. She knows national anthems are played for the winner. The band is playing God Save the King.
I thought I won, but after that, the band were playing the God Save the King, so I thought Maureen Gardner has won. Because you are nervous and you don't know if you have won, you know, and that is the trouble.
There is no announcement on the public address system, and there are no results printed on the official scoreboard.
After what I heard, the English King was arrived in the stadium.
God Save the King had been played to greet King George VI, not as a victory platform ceremony to honor Maureen Gardner of Great Britain. A few moments later, the results of the 80-meter hurdles are posted. Fanny Blankers-Koen, Holland first. Maureen Gardner, Great Britain second. After the race, Fanny Blankers-Koen is exhausted. She is about to withdraw from further competition.
The 200 meters I didn't like, but I said to my husband, two Olympic medals is enough. And he said, you can do it easily. Run a little bit slowly in the heat. And I have done it. And I was so tired. I made a bad time and I was tired and I was crying afterwards. I said to my husband, I don't like to run anymore. And I said, I want to go home and I want to the children. And he said, sorry, if you want to stop, okay, he said, but I'm sure afterwards you will be sorry that you have not been running.
It is August 6th, the final of the 200 meters. It is the first time that women will compete in this event. Fanny Blankers-Koen is again in lane one on the inside. The 200 meters is her least favorite event. Nevertheless, she has won her preliminary and semifinal heats. Blankers-Koen wins her third gold medal. Days later, Fanny Blankers-Koen will run the anchor leg on the 400-meter relay team. The Dutch team, second from the bottom, is 4 yards behind. Fanny Blankers-Koen, second from the left, makes up the distance quickly. Holland first, Australia second, Canada third. Fanny Blankers-Koen wins her fourth gold medal. One week later, she returns to Holland. It is a national holiday. She rides in a carriage throughout the city with her husband and children. One newspaper wrote, "It is a greater celebration than the one that took place on the day Holland was liberated during World War II.
That was very nice. And when I came home, everybody was standing out of the windows and they were standing up the tramway. And I was sitting in an open carriage with my husband, the children and my masseuse. And we went to the Lord Mayor and he was talking nice words to me, and then we went home and it was very nice. It was very exciting."
Fanny Blankers-Koen, the only woman in track and field history to win four gold medals in one Olympic Games, has come home. Melbourne, 1956. The opening day ceremonies of the 16th Olympiad of the modern Olympic era. One of the members of the host team from Australia, 19-year-old swimmer Dawn Fraser. More than a week later, the final of the women's 100-meter freestyle event. The favorites in the race, Dawn Fraser and her teammate Lorraine Crapp. Both Fraser and Crapp have won their preliminary and semi-final heats. Dawn Fraser is in lane four, fourth from the top. Lorraine Crapp is in lane five. Dawn Fraser makes the turn first. With 30 meters left, Dawn Fraser still leads. Dawn Fraser first, Lorraine Crapp second. Dawn Fraser wins her first gold medal. Before the games are over, she will win two more medals. Another gold is part of the victorious Australian 4x100 relay team, and a silver medal in the 400-meter freestyle. Rome, 1960. 22-year-old Dawn Fraser will attempt to become the first woman in Olympic history to win the 100 meters twice. Her main opposition, Chris Von Salza of the United States. Both Fraser and Von Salza have reached the finals undefeated. As they make the turn after 50 meters, Dawn Fraser takes the lead. Dawn Fraser first, Chris Von Salza, United States second. Now Dawn Fraser sets her sights for the Tokyo Olympic Games, 4 years away. Tokyo, 1964. 27-year-old Dawn Fraser is given the honor of carrying the Australian flag during the opening day ceremonies. A few days later, she will try to become the first swimmer in Olympic history to win three gold medals in the same event in three successive Olympiads. Here in the final, Dawn Fraser's main opposition is expected to come from Sharon Stouter of the United States. Fraser is closest to the camera with Stouter on her left. With 50 meters to go, Fraser is an arm's length ahead. Dawn Fraser, Australia first, in a new Olympic record. Sharon Stouter, United States second. For the third Olympiad in a row, Dawn Fraser receives the gold medal in the 100-meter freestyle. Following the Tokyo Olympics, Dawn Fraser was named Australian of the Year. Dawn Fraser, holder of 27 individual world records, and the only swimmer, male or female, to win three successive gold medals in the same event at the Olympic Games. It is November 1956, the final day of the track and field championships of the Melbourne Olympic Games. It is the day the women's 400-meter relay will be run. Till now, Australian women have won all the running races that have been contested. Here in the 80-meter hurdles, Shirley Strickland of Australia, at age 31, wins the race she won 4 years before in Helsinki. She becomes the first woman in history to win successive gold medals in the same event. In the sprints, 18-year-old Betty Cuthbert, second from the left, wins both the 100-meter and 200-meter runs. She follows in the footsteps of her countrywoman, Marjorie Jackson, who won the same races 4 years before in Helsinki. Ironically, the finish in the 200 meters is the same as in the 100. Betty Cuthbert, Australia first. Krista Studnick, Germany second. Marlene Matthews, Australia third. Now, Australian women as a team will go after their fourth gold medal in the 400-meter relay. Shirley Strickland will lead off for the Australians. This will be her last Olympic race. She has won medals in three Olympiads, London, Helsinki, and here in Melbourne. Because of the staggered lanes, it is difficult to see who is in front. Shirley Strickland, just passing off in the middle to Norma Croker, gives Australia a one-yard lead. Norma Croker continues to gain ground. For the third leg, she hands off to Fleur Mellor. But now Great Britain, alongside Australia, challenges for the lead. At the final pass-off, Betty Cuthbert of Australia has a 2-foot lead over Heather Armitage of Great Britain. Australia first, Great Britain second, United States third. For Betty Cuthbert, it is her third gold medal won here in Melbourne. She will win a fourth 8 years later in Tokyo. For Shirley Strickland, it is the end of her Olympic career. But in this final of the 400-meter relay, there is also the beginning of an Olympic career. Running the third leg for the United States on the right in lane one is a 16-year-old high school girl from Tennessee who until the age of 10 was unable to walk without braces, the result of polio. Her name, Wilma Rudolph. This is Wilma Rudolph today. She is the 20th child born into a family of 22. Her early years were spent on weekly trips to the hospital for polio treatments. She ran for the first time when she was 13. During the summer, under the guidance of Coach Ed Temple of Tennessee State University. It was Ed Temple who first told her about the Olympic Games.
When I got to the Olympics, I expected to see a city like the United States at 16. But everything was totally different. The language, the people, the food. I was quite lonely. It was difficult for me to train. Plus, I wanted to go home. I was a small town, southern girl, and I wasn't ready to share that southern accent with everybody.
It is Rome, 1960. Wilma Rudolph is one of the favorites to win the 100-meter dash. Her coach, Ed Temple, has been named to coach the United States women's track team competing in Rome.
He had a dream one night that I had won three Olympic gold medals in Rome, Italy. And he says, but I don't believe it, and I don't want you to believe it, but I want you to know this before you go.
It is Friday, September 2nd, 1960. Wilma Rudolph has won all her preliminary and semifinal heats. Dorothy Hyman of Great Britain is also undefeated. In her semifinal victory, Wilma Rudolph breaks the Olympic record set by Betty Cuthbert 4 years before. Wilma Rudolph, United States, first. Dorothy Hyman, Great Britain, second. Giuseppina Leone, Italy, third. Wilma Rudolph becomes the first American woman to win the 100-meter dash since the Berlin Games of 1936, when Helen Stevens won the gold medal. Final step to the victory platform has been long and painful. Wilma Rudolph, at age 10, unable to walk without braces. Wilma Rudolph, age 20, Olympic gold medal winner and fastest woman in the world. In 4 days, Wilma Rudolph will try for her second gold medal in the 200 meters. It is September 6th. Wilma Rudolph has again won all her preliminary and semifinal heats. Wilma Rudolph is in lane one on the inside. Jutta Heine of Germany is in lane four, and Dorothy Hyman, Great Britain, lane five. Coming off the final turn, Wilma Rudolph in lane one leads. Wilma Rudolph first, Jutta Heine second, Dorothy Hyman third. 3 days later, Wilma Rudolph takes the final pass off in the 400-meter relay. United States first, Germany second, Poland third. Wilma Rudolph wins her third gold medal.
I was so excited that one of the girls from West Germany was the closest person by, so we just decided to rejoice. And by the time I got back to my teammates, I think we were all in tears at that time. And the greatest thrill about the relay team was that I was able to be with three people that I had worked with for years, and the four of us crowding on that one step to receive our gold medals and punching each other all during the course of everything and sort of holding hands and making sure that everybody got the same amount of everything because it was important.
This is the Palace of Versailles, about 1 hour's drive from Paris. A few hundred meters from this magnificent structure built during the reign of Louis XIV, lives Madame Micheline Ostermeyer. Micheline Ostermeyer is one of Europe's most renowned concert pianists. She performed her first solo concert when she was 25 years old. In 1948, Micheline Ostermeyer was 27 years old. She would compete in the London Olympic Games. If it were not for the four victories of Fanny Blankers-Koen, Micheline Ostermeyer would have been the outstanding performer at the London Olympic Games. Micheline Ostermeyer, concert pianist, won gold medals in the shot put and discus, and won the bronze medal in the high jump.
J'étais toute ma vie, il y avait qu'un mois que je lançais le disque, même ça paraît vraiment absurde.
The discus championship was very exciting. It was a new event for me. When the competition started, I was afraid I would embarrass myself. I even thought I might hit one of the officials, because I really didn't know how to throw it. An Italian girl was in front after her first throw. I had one throw left. There was a loud cheer, and I knew I had either hit someone with the discus or won the gold medal. Fortunately, it was the second of the two alternatives.
If I mag zien.
Micheline Ostermeyer wins her first gold medal. 2 days later, she is entered in the shot put.
The shot put was another strange situation. It was the first time that women competed in that event in the Olympic Games. Unlike the discus, I had trained 4 years in the shot put, and I thought I had a chance to win. This time, I was not afraid of hitting anyone.
Micheline Ostermeyer wins her second gold medal. 2 days later, she enters the high jump. She comes in third, winning the bronze medal. Throughout her entire career, in the discus, shot put, and high jump, she is never injured.
The event that most frightened me in connection with my hands was the high jump. I always landed on my arms and wrists. But fortunately, I never missed a concert because of any injury. I was never frightened when I competed in athletics. It was a great pleasure, a joy. The only time I have any apprehensions are the moment right before I start to play at a concert. Then, I am really scared.
Micheline Ostermeyer's Olympic career is now over. For the next 2 years, she continues on in national competition, winning French championships in the shot put, discus, and hurdles. But now she would devote the future to her other love, the concert stages of the world. October 15, 1968, Mexico City. The final of the women's 100-meter dash. The favorite in the race is 23-year-old Wyomia Tyus of the United States. For Wyomia Tyus, it is the second time she has made it to the final. 4 years before, at the Tokyo Olympic Games when she was 19, she won all her heats in preparation for the race for the gold medal.
At that time, Coach Temple had told me, you know, you've made the team, you should be very happy you made the team. And all through the trials and the heats and everything, he was like, you know, good that you made it this far and now make it to the finals. He said, you know, it's just great that you made it to the finals. Maybe you have a chance to win a medal, you know. And I was just, you know, really very young and saying, you know, my coach knows. He knows what he's talking about. So I was just very happy to just even be there.
Wyomia Tyus is third from the left. Her teammate, Edith McGuire, second from the left. Their main opposition will come from Eva Klobuchowska of Poland in lane one on the extreme right.
The gun goes off and I see Klobuchowska on my left out there. And I go, what the hell? I'm sitting, I'm really concentrating. What? How can she do that? I mean, how can she do this to me? I mean, I've really been concentrating. So 50 yards down the straightaway and she's still out there. And then I'm saying, well, gee, where's Edith? And I could always remember what Temple would tell us. Don't look for them. They'll be there. I mean, if you look for them, they're passing you by. While you're looking to the right, they're passing you on the left or something of that nature. So here I am just running at the 70 yards, I'm up right on her, you know. And I kept saying, well, gee, am I going to pass her? What's going to happen? I mean, I got, you know, about 30 more yards to go. And, you know, I get to finish. It was like a surge out, so to speak. I just leaned out and I, you know, beat her by a second or so.
Wyomia Tyus first, Edith McGuire second, Eva Klobuchowska, Poland, third. On the way to winning her gold medal, Wyomia Tyus broke the world and Olympic record set 4 years before by Wilma Rudolph. Now she sets her sights for the Mexico City Olympic Games of 1968. It is October 15th, 1968, Mexico City, the final of the 100-meter dash. there are eight finalists. Chi Cheng, Taiwan. Raylene Boyle and Diane Burge, Australia. Miguelina Kobian, Cuba. Ina Kirzenstein, Poland. And Margaret Bales, Barbara Farrell, and Wyomia Tyus of the United States. No athlete, male or female, has ever repeated winning the 100-meter dash. 23-year-old Wyomia Tyus will now make that attempt.
The press really gave me a lot of bad write-ups that I should retire, that, you know, it's never been done for somebody to come back and repeat themselves in the Olympics, in the 100 meters, that is. And, you know, I was washed up, in other words, that's what they say. So I really had a lot to prove to the press, and I think that helped me a great deal in the 68 Olympics. I don't think anybody could have told me I could not win that race. I think that race, I knew it. Even before we started, I was going to win that. So much so that I had told some people in the stands that I was going to do this dance at the time that was out called the Tighten Up. But most people thought I was doing some exercises or whatever, but it really wasn't. I was doing a dance called the Tighten Up, and I was just dancing around and everything. And what's really funny about that, a couple months later, Raylene Boyle, who was in the race from Australia, came over to our house, and she was saying, Wyomia, I just want to ask you one thing. I said, what's that? In the finals of that 100 meters in Mexico City, you were doing some of those strange exercises. What was those strange exercises? And I said, oh, that was a dance called the Tighten Up. So I tighten up before I would run, so I would be very loose in the race, you know.
Wyomia Tyus has one fear, the threat of rain. She does not like a wet track. Margaret Bales of the United States breaks.
We almost had the downpour rain, and they jump, and I go, oh, damn it, why in the hell are you jumping? I mean, it's going to rain. I don't want the rain to come.
Now they are ready again. Barbara Farrell of the United States breaks. Now they will try for the third time. If Bales or Farrell breaks a second time, they will be disqualified. The start is clean. The three Americans in the middle are out first. Barbara Farrell on the left has a slight lead at 30 meters, followed by Wyomia Tyus in lane three. Between them is Margaret Bales. At 50 meters, it is Farrell and Tyus. Kirzenstein on the left makes her bid. Wyomia Tyus first, Barbara Farrell second, Irena Kirzenstein third. For Wyomia Tyus, the victory is the fulfillment of a commitment she made to herself 4 years before in Tokyo. To become the only athlete, male or female, to win successive gold medals in the 100-meter dash.
I think that medal really meant a lot to me because I'd been having a bad year, and it was like, gosh, I really want to go out on the top. Winning a gold medal in 100 meters back-to-back consecutive in two Olympic Games had never been done before. And, like, you know, that really meant a lot to me. So I really wanted to, like, go out on the top.
The rain finally comes, and the thousands of spectators leave the Estadio Olimpico. But now it is time for Wyomia Tyus to receive her reward, to stand on the top step of the victory platform. Before the race, Wyomia Tyus was alone in the belief that she could win. And now that she has done what no one else has ever done, she is again alone. Tokyo, 1964, the 18th Olympiad of the modern era. For Tokyo, it is a day that has arrived 24 years late. The 1940 Games, originally scheduled for Tokyo, were canceled because of World War II. Now, more than two decades later, the athletes are greeted by Emperor Hirohito in an atmosphere of joy and remembrance. The final torchbearer approaches the urn that will hold the Olympic flame throughout the games. What many of the 75,000 spectators do not know is that the entrance of 19-year-old Yoshinori Sakai symbolizes a dual theme. The glory of the ancient games that stretches over more than 2,000 years, and a remembrance of the tragedy of World War II. For Yoshinori Sakai was born on August 6, 1945, near Hiroshima, the day the first atomic bomb was dropped. It is Friday, October 13, 1964. The game of volleyball is introduced into the Olympic Games. Volleyball began in the United States in 1895, but the world's greatest teams have come from the Soviet Union and Japan. Russian and Japanese teams have won every gold medal contested in Olympic competition. A few years before the Tokyo Games, a women's team called the Kaizuka Amazons was selected to represent Japan. 12 women who worked for a company called Dai Nippon. The Kaizuka Amazons had an incredible record. They won 137 consecutive games. This is Hirofumi Daimatsu. He is employed by Dai Nippon as an office manager. He is also the coach of the Kaizuka Amazons. Preparing for the 1964 Olympic Championship, Hirofumi Daimatsu set up a training program that to many was an insult to human dignity. In effect, Daimatsu set up a military camp. He was the commanding general, and the team members were there to obey. Hirofumi Daimatsu devised a program of training that defied the imagination. The training sessions were brutal mixtures of mental and physical pain. Scrimmages would consist of non-stop series of dives, rolls, and tumbles. Individual sessions were designed to shatter the spirit of the girl. Hirofumi Daimatsu was preparing them for that crucial moment when victory could be turned to defeat. Hirofumi Daimatsu made them two promises. Those who could not survive would be released from the team. But for those who could endure, he promised an Olympic gold medal. It is October 23rd, 1964, the final match for the women's volleyball gold medal. Japan and the Soviet Union are both undefeated. Each team has won four consecutive matches. Now, here in the final, they meet for the championship in the best three out of five games. In volleyball, the team getting 15 points first is the winner, but the game must be won by at least 2 points. Points can only be scored by the serving team. The Japanese women have won the first two games by scores of 15-11 and 15-9. Now in the third game, they lead by the score of 14-9. The Japanese are serving. If they win the point, the gold medal is theirs. The serve goes over to the Russians. The Russians win the point. They now trail 14-10. The Russians score again. They now trail 14-11. Another point for the Russians. Japan still leads 14-12. Japan wins the serve. They still need 1 point for the gold medal. Russia again gets the serve. The Russians score again. They trail 14-13. The Japanese win the serve. They lead 14-13, still 1 point from victory. The Russian girl's hand goes over the net. It is a foul. The point is awarded to the Japanese. The final score, Japan 15, Soviet Union 13. The Japanese women have won 3 straight games and the Olympic championship. Victory return to them any part of what they gave. Yet all of them know they share an experience that will remain with them throughout their lifetime. For they are Olympic champions, and what binds them together is that they fulfilled the promise of Hirofumi Daimatsu. If you can endure, you will win the gold medal.